rat.
Oh no.
And Blasters proudly presents a special episode discussing Chapter 13 of the Star Wars series, The Mandalorian. Yes, you know, I love our original, you know, theme music for Blurrgs and Blasters, but when we hit these Blurrgs and Blasters episodes, I love it. You know, I just love this song so much.
Oh yeah, catch you going. It's different.
Makes me feel things. Oh yeah, yeah.
Very true, man.
I feel nice. Hey, how does this show keep on getting better and better? I don't understand. Right?
You know, I tried to think of what other show got better and better with every episode, and I couldn't think of one.
No, there's no show. There's no show that's just a straight ramp. You know, shows dip; they go up and down and up and down, and you know they reach a height and then they just keep on going down. This show just keeps on going up and up and up and up and up and up and up, and there's no end in sight. It just gets better and better with every episode, and I don't understand. I don't understand what's gonna happen.
You know something's really good when it's 30 to 40 minutes long, right? But yeah. It actually feels like 4 minutes. And you're like, how is this over already?
Yeah, what happened? Yeah, I need more of this. I need more.
Yeah, that's why I'm like, oh, come on. Like, it's over already? Like, can we stop making these episodes like an hour and a half? Can every episode be a movie length?
Yeah, let's
can
do that.
Can they do that?
Just an hour and a half every week. We got to do that. Yeah, please. What's up, guys? This is Blurrgs and Blasters. You found it, and we are excited tonight because we're talking about a monumental episode, The Jedi. Ooh, Chris, this one was something, man. I really, really enjoyed it. Like the past episodes were amazing, but this is like next level. You know, we took two steps forward, no steps back. Everything we found, Ahsoka's back, Ahsoka Tano in live action. Live action forevermore. What do you like? Do you think she's ever going back to animation? I don't. I don't think there's any. I don't think we're looking back here, man. We have Ahsoka in live action, and there she shall remain. I can't.
Yeah,
hear you.
I mean, no doubt.
You did it already. It's already John Madden.
Yeah, I mean, I think she looked incredible, which we all assumed that she was going to. They picked the perfect actress.
Oh, yeah.
To bring her to live action, and everything just looks so good. It looks so real. I don't know, man. I don't know exactly when you want to just jump right into this. So I'm just gonna.
Chris, this episode, we usually go like, line by line by line by everything that happens. We're just talking. We're talking about this one. Let's just jump into whatever we want to jump into. There's so much. You guys watched the episode. You know what happened. We're here to just like, just rock out. We're just rocking out, man. You know, we're going to talk Michael Biehn. All right. We're going to talk about those creatures in the background. All right. I want to talk about those, the creatures in the forest. We got to talk about those bad boys. We need to talk about the child's name.
Grogu.
We need to talk about Grogu. I will always say it like that too. You know, we have a lot of things to bring up right now.
So what I absolutely love how The Mandalorian delivers is that usually with TV shows, there's some kind of build up to the reveal of a loved character.
Mm.
Right when this episode starts, you just see her white lightsabers. It's just right off the bat, you have Ahsoka. It's just like, boom, here's Ahsoka.
Straight murdering.
Like, exactly. There wasn't no like, okay, we know that the Mandalorian is going to go find her.
Yeah.
There was no like,
Luke Skywalker
the Mandalorian
at the end.
Traveling.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It was like, the show started. I think we see her the first minute
yep.
of the show.
First couple of seconds. first couple of seconds, she's right there. Yeah. So, yeah, it really was. Like, the episode's called The Jedi, and you get your Jedi's worth out of this, for sure. It was so great. Rosario Dawson freaking nailed it. She's perfect. She's a perfect Ahsoka, you know? I absolutely loved her performance. I loved the character design. I loved the costume. I love her. The personality she conveyed in Ahsoka is just so, so experienced, yet at the same time, very wise, you know? But with a hint of charm. She had a bit of charm about her, too. I really did enjoy, like, just everything she brought to the character. Because that's Rosario Dawson. She is so talented. I've been a huge Rosario Dawson fan, I don't know, 25 years now, since Kids. Remember Kids?
You know, I do. That's a really messed up movie.
Yeah. She wasn't even in acting school then.
Well, I'm sure everybody that was involved in that movie, like, that was, like, their test run of acting.
Pretty much.
I will admit, she's been in a lot of things, but she grew on me hard in Clerks 2. Because you have like this, like, burst of energy and beauty, and she's totally the perfect person to cast for something serious or something funny or something romantic. Or she knows how to play whatever role is, you know, gets put on her lap.
Oh, yeah, 100%. 100%.
And people need to, like, understand, too, how hard it is to bring an animated character to a live action.
Doesn't happen much.
It doesn't happen much, and when it does happen...
looks terrible.
You usually get the, okay.
Okay.
This one, I was like, damn.
She's here.
It's perfect.
She's here. She's arrived. Here. Yeah, here we are. Yeah.
So like you said... I mean, I think she's the perfect actress to be casted as Ahsoka. Mm-hmm. I think she played it beautifully. Mm-hmm. All her features were totally there.
Yeah.
You know, so whoever is in charge of casting is really nailing this.
Well, I mean, there's a good story about that. I was reading about it, you know, like, and I think that Favreau and Filoni chose her after hearing that she was interested for a couple of years in playing the character.
Did Favreau ever work with her? Like, do any of them have relationships with her?
Yeah, Favreau worked with Favreau knew her. So,
do you know what project?
I don't know if it was a project or if they just kind of knew each other.
Mutual friends, kind of like a Bill Burr type deal. Like,
yeah,
they, like, how Favreau met Bill Burr was through Vince Vaughn.
Really?
Yeah, because F is for Family, I believe Vince Vaughn has his hands in that.
I think his
production company.
Yeah.
And it was something like there was like a dinner and they hit it off and it was kind of wild. But I mean, that's Hollywood, baby, right?
That's it. You get a stew, baby. That's it. You know? Yeah. Yeah. I mean, so it was a bit of the fan casting that got her there. And then, you know, Favreau knew her and, you know, Favreau called Filoni and was like, you know, so. You know, hey, who are you thinking for Ahsoka? And he's like, Rosario is my first pick. And he's like, great, I know her. And yeah, that was it, you know?
I want somebody to even just dare to try to do a better Filoni impression.
Really? Is that good?
Dude, it's good. It is good.
Chris, I've been throwing impressions at you for years, and I didn't know this was going to be the one.
Well, this is the thing, like... You do a great job reminding me how long we've been doing this for. So you had how many years? 6 years?
Yeah, we're in our seventh year now. We're in our seventh year.
So
we finished 6 years.
7 years of going, you guys.
You guys.
You, like, now, the more you keep saying it, if I close my eyes, I'm like, is it Joe or Dave? I don't.
Yeah, my middle name is actually Dave. David. So.
Are you for real?
Yes. My middle name is David.
Okay,
so,
well, for the people that are listening, we are good friends, and I did not know that.
Well,
so.
Yeah, I don't know what your name is, what your middle name is.
Dude, my name's Christopher from Revere. What do you think my middle name is?
It would be funny if it was Chris. Christopher.
That would be funny.
Yeah.
But I'm going to give you a hint.
Francesco?
No, they used about six names. In my generation. So you have six names to pick from.
You got Justin, Jason.
Nope.
Luca.
All right. You know a lot of them. It's a very common name.
Vinny.
No. What? What are you gonna say, Salvi?
Yeah, like, actually, Salvatore is probably next.
Michael, there's a ton of Michael.
Oh, geez, yeah, there is. Michael is, yeah, of course it is. Of course it is. Yeah.
I swear, dude, there was like, six names. Everybody was either like Chris, Mike, Joe, Bob. I don't know. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Not a lot of Joes. Not a lot of Joes in my time. I gotta tell you, I don't meet a lot of Joes my age. It's all right, though. I like being the one. You know, that makes me happy.
I like how you went straight like Bronx Tale. Christopher
from Revere. I mean, I figured, like, you know, we came from an Italian American community. It changed over time, but that's what we grew up with. So, you know, I figured your baptism name is usually pretty Italian. You know,
right.
Mine wasn't, but you know, these things happen. These things happen. I don't know. Whoa. Where are we right now?
Yeah, what just happened? All right,
what
Rosario
just happened? Rosario Dawson. Mandalorian. Hey, I liked how she faded in and out of the mist. You know, like she attacked.
Yes.
Yeah. I loved that. I thought that was so cool. Very ninja-like. Very stealthy. Very, you know... Do you think I think the Force was involved in that. I liked that. You know, it's like very much like in the tradition of Obi-Wan, you know, sneaking around the Death Star.
You know, I mean, I know it's a TV show and all that, but if you were on that side and if you saw a Jedi and you're just an average Joe, I would just be like, you know, guys, I'm tapping out here. Like, we're not going to win this. So
she murdered them. She straight up murdered. Like, this wasn't like, ha, 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 battle droids, the girls killing the battle droids, yay, the girls killing the, she killed the robots, look, children, watch the girl kill the robots, it's good. No, this is Ahsoka, the woman, and she murders. She straight up murdered, like, 12 guys before even, like, the title card. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know?
This is true, yeah. Just, it had to be at least a dozen, or a baker's dozen.
Yeah. I mean, really. Yeah. She carved them up like a Thanksgiving turkey. I know, I carved my own turkey this year, so I know about these things, you know?
You do.
Yeah, you do.
And
you know.
the turkey looked damn good, too.
It was great. It was great. I gotta tell you. I want to do it again. Now I'm like addicted to doing turkeys now. I mean,
well, hey,
I mean cooking them. Yeah.
Guess what? It doesn't need to be Thanksgiving.
No, not at all. Not for two turkeys like us. All right, so you know something that a lot more about Ahsoka. Let's talk about Ahsoka a little more. I think Rosario Dawson is the Ahsoka from now on. I don't think there is going to be another cast. I don't think they're going back to animation. I think the live action series is probably in the works. I really hope so. And you know, I gotta say, I have to give Ashley Eckstein a lot of credit for kind of passing the torch. She was very gracious about it. You know, and hey, if Ashley Eckstein is your Ahsoka, I get it. That's like, you know, people are like I think of like James Bond. Some people some people, Sean Connery will always be their James Bond. You know, they may like they may like Timothy Dalton, they may like Pierce Brosnan, they may like Daniel Craig, they may like the two guys I can't remember at the moment, but I know their names. Two other guys. Everyone's screaming at their computers right now.
No, I can't think of them either, to be honest with you, because there was like older Bonds.
Yeah, I can't think of these are very
dude. They had to be elite. I think there was like eight Bonds, like eight actors that played James.
I mentioned most of them. I forgot George Lazenby and Roger Moore, two of the most iconic ones. On Her Majesty's Secret Service, and of course Roger Moore, who is like iconic in the role. I totally forgot about them, but that's all right. Yeah, but anyways, for some people, everyone has their own James Bond. I'm gonna say a couple things controversial right now. You know, saying that, you know, whoever your Ahsoka is, that's cool. But you know something? I think Rosario Dawson is my Ahsoka, and this is saying it as a person who saw the Clone Wars in the theaters in 2008 and watched every episode on its premiere date. When it was on TV, I think that I've finally found like the Ahsoka that I really, really love, the incarnation of the character. No disrespect to Ashley Eckstein at all. I think Ashley Eckstein did a good job. for Ahsoka as a kid and into a teen. But I've never been like an Ashley Eckstein quote unquote fan. You know what I mean? It's not like I dislike her. I think she did a good job, but I've never been like, you know what I mean? There are Ashley Eckstein fans, and Ashley Eckstein has done a lot of things deserve praise. You know, her universe is amazing. She single-handedly really did do a lot of work for females in Star Wars and in sci-fi in general. I got to give her a lot of credit for that. But her portrayal of Ahsoka, I think, was good, but it didn't set my world on fire. You know what I mean? I always thought it was just good. yeah. I'm not friends with her. I've never done an interview with her. You know, it's not something where I'm like a huge fan of her work. So I say, you know, job well done in bringing the character to life. You deserve a lot of credit, but the job is done now, and the torch has been passed. You know, there is no more Team Ahsoka. There is really just now Rosario has the role, and yeah, I'm looking forward to the future. I don't know, Chris, what do you think about this? I don't expect you to agree with me. You don't have to, but I don't know. It's just one man's take.
No, I mean, I appreciate, you know, your opinion. And I think everybody's opinion, you know, matters.
Totally.
You know what I mean?
Everyone's totally
entitled to their own opinion. You know what I mean? Because if everybody thought the same, this would be a really weird world.
Yeah, exactly. You know, exactly.
But I do agree on Ashley owning the animated version of Ahsoka, and now Rosaria is Ahsoka live action.
Yeah.
I like we said multiple times in the past 5 minutes, I think she just brought it to the next level.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Like, yeah, she really did.
This is the very mature Ahsoka that should be in the show and what we should be seeing.
Yeah. A grown ass woman. Poised, wise. There's just so much gravitas that Rosario brought to that role, and you know, we're not in the young, perky, you know, aspect, you know, era of her life, you know, and I think Ashley brought a lot of energy to that. But she has this kind of Disney princess feel too, you know. I think there's a little bit of a Disney princess to her portrayal, and not in a bad way. I just think there's a little bit there of that sort of energy and that youthfulness to Ashley Eckstein's voice and her role, which was great. You know, I mean, that's where the character was born. But you know, I think that if you want the next level, you want a different stage in her life, you go to someone like Rosario, who can take what Ashley did, and she definitely, you know, she says that she took a lot from Ashley's performance and really respected it, and she just, you know, I think she just brought it to the next level. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I'm absolutely. I mean, you really did say it best, you know.
Okay. All right.
Whatever I'm going to say is going to kind of repeat what you just said in probably different words, but we're going to get the same result. I really think we should just kind of be like, listen, your animation, your live action,
yeah,
you both did a great job. There's no disrespect to Ashley, you know, and I was wondering when they did cast Rosario,
yeah,
if they were going to dub over her voice. And I thought for a second, I was like, if they dubbed over her voice, that would kind of be a smack in the face, because she's a well-respected actress that is more than capable of pulling this off. And I'm really happy that not only we got the appearance, but we got her voice too. This is the next stage of Ahsoka, and everything that they did was necessary.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think it really would be a slap in the face to overdub her voice. There's nothing wrong with her voice at all, and you know, I think, you know, Ashley Eckstein is a great, she's a great you know, voice actor, and that's fine. But I think that her portrayal coming out of Rosario Dawson's mouth would just be silly. It would be silly.
Yeah. Right. But you know how they, you know, the only reason why I thought that is because, you know, how sometimes they do like fan service or like, I mean, in Star Wars, they have dubbed over a lot.
You know, Rosario. Rosario has done a ton of voice work too. That's crazy.
I'm. You know, this is the thing. I'm not familiar, but I'm sure if you were to mention a few things, I would be like, "Holy crap! I should have known that."
She's been Wonder Woman, for like DC animated stuff for years. She does video games all the time. Yeah, I mean, she's done a lot. Didn't you like the game Syndicate on the PS3?
No.
No. Oh, okay. Well, she did that. Yeah, she's done a ton of voice acting over the decades.
Dude, You need to tell your buddy Bill to hire her to do some voices in his video game so we could chill with her.
I think that sounds great. I mean, they're...
Dude, yeah. That's Hollywood, baby.
Yeah, the deep end games, guys. They're an indie studio. I don't know what finances they got, but you know something? I'll put the word out there. I'll say, hey, you gotta hire Rosario Dawson. And when he stops laughing, he'll probably get back to me. they just actually got funded for a Kickstarter, Romancevania. It's a Metroidvania.
Oh, that's a good name.
It's a Metroidvania, but has like elements of like The Bachelor in it. It looks freaking wacky. Absolutely wacky. And I'm really excited to play it.
They're going whack pack style.
Oh, went whack pack like you wouldn't believe. I didn't think they had it in them. And it's like, yeah, yeah. Woo! Way over there.
How funny.
I love
it. How funny would that? That would be the most interesting episode of Brews and Blasters. It's like, so guys, we're at The Whistle with Rosario and...
oh my God.
We're actually all really good friends now.
It's, yeah. Turns out
if you don't believe us, look at the show art.
Yeah, we're best friends.
We just hammered. Yeah, we just hammered with her.
We're going to talk about a Jedi we did get hammered with once later on in the episode, too. It's called a tease.
That actually happened as well.
Yeah, we did. We have gotten hammered with a member of the Jedi Council.
I am a man of my word, and if the Jedi that reached out to Grogu is Oporansis, I am Liu Kang. With Liu Kang,
right down the street,
like
Liu Kang,
right through my TV.
Yeah. I'm gonna punch a wall like a Terminator on malfunction, and it just can't stop doing it. I'm just gonna just punch the wall, like take that stance, you know.
You know how he does that bicycle kick.
Yeah.
I'm gonna do that in real life.
Yeah, Liu Kang bicycle kick. Yeah, I'm gonna be like ED-909 in RoboCop, or is it ED-209? I forget. And I'm just gonna mow down a bunch of 80s corporate people in a boardroom.
Joe, that was a kids' movie.
I saw it as a child. I did.
Dude, I saw that movie when I was 5 years old.
And we were talking about this over the weekend because we were talking about like watching. I showed my daughter A New Hope, a little bit of A New Hope, and she loved it. You know. Mm. Yeah. We were talking about that over the weekend. It was good stuff. Oh, yeah. I saw that as a kid. You know.
Yeah. The times were definitely different. I mean, they blew Alex Murphy to pieces, literally.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I was just like sitting on the couch like this.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let's go buy some action figures, I guess, right?
Yep, I learned about
female. Remember the
yeah, I learned about female anatomy from learning about Ghostbusters. The first 5 minutes of Ghostbusters. Yeah.
Well, those RoboCop figures, they actually had caps that you would put in the back, you know.
Oh yeah.
And
he had
like this little trigger, and dude, it was like gunpowder, and sometimes it got on you.
Oh yeah, sometimes it got on you. We played with gunpowder.
You have to appreciate the 80s toys, you know.
Oh, 100%. 100%. It was just...
Dude,
it was
we are
wacky.
So off the rails right now. Holy crap. I think we got into the first 2 minutes of this episode.
Oh, I mean, it's all right. It's all right. We'll get back there. This is Brews and Blasters, guys. Cool. I mean, if you guys wanted a really strict, tight episode that only focused on the Star Wars lore, go listen to another show. We're having fun tonight, you know? I got the whiskey out. It's a pretty... That's a heavy pour. That's a heavy pour.
It's a full glass.
Yeah.
If I didn't know any better, I thought that was a full like glass of apple juice, but it's not.
No, not at all. Yeah, that's the whiskey because that's the type of night. That's the night it's been. I've had a long day. All right, let's get back to it though.
So slicing and dicing.
Yeah, murdering people. One thing I will say too. Just one last thing. Whoever your Ahsoka is, that's totally cool. If you had an issue with her headtails. Just hit stop, go get a horse, go to the mountains, don't bother no one. No one wants you around. Like who would make an issue of that after this unbelievable episode? Right?
I didn't understand it.
I woke up the next day, I was so psyched about this episode, I was ready to like talk to you about it on our group chat with Bill from Dork Leia, and like I look on my phone and people are just like being like Star Trek nerds from like the 90s, like being like, I took me out of it that her head tails weren't long enough. Ugh. She's murdering people. She's murdering people. They're doing stunts, guys. I'm sorry. I'm talking over you, Chris, but I can't handle it. I can't handle it.
No, I'm right there with you, you know, and people really not need to start like dialing it back a little bit and just like appreciating what we're getting.
Live action Ahsoka.
Like them nitpicking about the smallest little things. Come on, guys, we're better than this. Okay.
It worked. Guess what? Bringing her to live action worked, you know?
Guess what? Her headtails, that was the last thing on my mind.
Yeah.
I had to pick up my jaw by the time that episode was over because I was in such awe of how amazing it was. I looked at her quite often and I just kept saying, damn, she looks great.
Me
now,
too.
Her headtails being 2 inches shorter than like the animation or whatever. Yeah. Guys, get over it, please. Yeah. Oh my God.
Yeah. You know how it went with me? You go, headtails are shorter. Okay. And I just moved on. You know what I started to think about after that? I go, oh, Michael Biehn. Michael Biehn, they did it. They did it.
Right when I saw him up. Yeah, right when he was up on that like little balcony.
Yeah, you magnificent
bastard.
There
he is.
There's Michael Biehn. Yeah. Yeah. Guys, have we ever told you the story of how we almost met Michael Biehn but didn't?
Oh, my God.
Oh, yes. Yes, we were at
Rhode Island. We could tell it real quick. Because,
Rhode Island Comic Con. I mean, yes, that's right.
And this was the first time that this incident ever happened at Rhode Island Comic Con.
It's
true. So they let way too many people in, and the fire marshal shut it down.
Yeah.
So, well, didn't shut down the convention, shut down the people coming in, or it was basically going or coming. So if you were in and you left, they wouldn't let you back in.
You couldn't get back
in.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
So I blew it because I was literally like, you know, like he just had a regular table in one of the aisles and I was straight up staring at him. And
he
was doing the like the kid, I see you. Yeah. Like, you're going to come up to my table.
There
you
was
know?
No line. There and was I no did... line. He was just sitting there.
Oh, there was no line.
There was no line.
There.
We're talking 30 bucks for a picture and an autograph.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
And there was a black and white picture. It looked like a, like, you know, like the press photos of Hicks from Aliens.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously that's what I would have him sign if I was going to have him sign something.
All right. That's not that obvious because I mean, I'm a Kyle Reese Michael Biehn guy too, you know?
No, I total respect for Terminator.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. But we're talking about Mount Olympus here.
I mean, I loved Aliens. I loved the whole, like, Space Marines, like, all of that. And the picture looks so badass, man.
Mm-hmm.
Black and white. He's holding the pulse rifle. And I'm like, this guy looks amazing, you know? And then I was just like, you know what I did? You know how me and you do this all the time?
Mm-hmm.
Because we have all day.
Mm-hmm.
We'll circle back. It doesn't need
He's
to be
there.
Right now.
Yeah, we're okay. Yeah, we don't seize the day. And we should.
So, let's put it this way. So, long story short, like, I think his girlfriend or his wife got sick. He went back to the hotel room.
Quote-unquote got sick. Quote-unquote.
Yeah.
You know what it was, dude?
So...
you tell the story, and then I'll say what really happened.
Well, he had every intentions of coming back, and then they wouldn't let him back in, the fire marshal. So he was just like, okay, screw it. I'll see you tomorrow.
Yeah.
You know, and then that's when I was like, I blew it.
Yeah.
Okay. I blew it. I'm not going to meet him now.
So that's one thing that they said happened. We've heard that story from Rhode Island Comic Con officials. Here's what I think happened. I think that Michael Biehn was having a real slow day at the convention in like 2014, 2015. When, like, yeah, I don't even know how many people still recognize Michael Biehn, and even in this, you know, for the greatness that he is in this episode, you know? So I don't know what happened there. I think that he was having a real slow day at the convention, and he basically was like, I'm just gonna call it an early day, you know? And I think that, I think that maybe we might have been lied to in trying to come back. A likely story. Because if the fire marshal said, hey, sir, you can't come in. He goes, have you ever seen Aliens? Have you ever seen Terminator? You know? Come with me.
Have you ever seen action movies in the 80s and early 90s?
Yeah.
Know who I am?
Fire Marshal, hold out the hand. Come with me if you want to live.
Ring a bell?
Yeah, exactly. And then they let him back in because he's Michael Biehn. So I don't buy it. I think Michael Biehn went back to his hotel, hung out with his girlfriend, and just had a very nice evening. And we're just sitting by his table for 2 hours being like, is he coming? I don't know. And then we call it a day.
Dude, I actually remember being like a little on the sad side. Like,
we were pretty pissed.
Like, I was like, I blew it. Well, like, it's one of those things, like, one thing that I noticed about Rhode Island Comic Con, if they brought an actor or an actress, there's a good chance they're going to bring them back, mm-hmm. because it seems like they form good relationships with these people to get them back easy enough.
Yes. He didn't come back. He never came back.
He didn't come back. Also, yeah. did you guys ever see The Rock with Sean Connery? He was yeah. in that.
Yeah, Welcome to The Rock.
The Abyss? Oh, I don't know. He was in that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And now he's in
tonight.
Star Wars.
Awesome, funny movie.
Yep. He was in that.
And now he's in Star Wars. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And now he's in Star Wars as Lang is his name. Yeah. Yeah.
Lang?
Lang. L-A-N-G. Yeah. What'd you think about Michael Biehn's performance? Because I thought it was very different. I wasn't expecting it. He was very stiff.
I was just going to say, it was very... Now, we are praising him, by the
yeah.
way. That we're not knocking him.
No, I'm not knocking him. It was not the performance I expected from the guy.
What I got was, like, a stiff general-type feel. The
military
of a guy,
man. Yeah.
Yeah, that's been through it time after time, and this is just another gig to him.
Yeah.
You know, like, because... And even now, I know I'm going to fast forward to almost the end, but it was like it was a job to him. There was no attachment to that woman that he was working for.
No, not at all. Hey, remember Major Dad? Remember the show Major Dad? Have you heard of that show?
It sounds familiar.
This is like what Major Dad would do, like after he quit the military and was retired, but then, like, I don't know, Social Security benefits were running out, so he had to get like another job, you know, like consulting.
Yeah.
He became a consultant. Later on, after post-retirement, just earn a yeah. couple of bucks. You know, that's who Lang is. You know, that he's
also,
he's stiff. He's Major Dad.
Also, that like the war hero that
mm-hmm.
Is always looking for his last hurrah.
Yes. Yeah.
Because I don't think he wanted to live. Like, because he could have walked. He could have walked.
Yeah. Exactly.
And he knew what the Mandalorian is basically covered in a bulletproof, like, suit.
Yeah, you know what Beskar was. Yeah.
Yeah. That's
you a hunter?
Like,
I love that, too. Not a bounty hunter. You a hunter?
Well, that's
yeah.
what I was like. Right when he was putting down his weapon, I was like, this is the classic. He's going to try to shoot him. He's going to die.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Exactly. Hey, how about... And then the robot on the roof right afterwards. Love that.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's great. Robot. The droid. The hunter-killer droid. The Ralph McQuarrie-inspired hunter-killer.
Yes.
Yeah.
I just thought it was good when you heard, like, the Beskar, spear drop, and he was like, sounds like, you win.
Yeah, sounds like you win. Yeah. Oh, my gosh. It was so good. Yeah, you knew something was gonna happen, and Mando was totally prepared for it. Yeah. Yeah. So, let's get back to the planet itself, Caladan. Total Dune reference right there. But the planet, you know, it was supposed to be a forest planet, but it's, like, a scorched and, like, forest... It's scorched earth, totally. Like, there was a forest fire.
Yeah.
Did you see the creatures in the background?
I did.
I know
really
you did.
Cool.
They looked almost like giant blurgs. But
I
like,
was going to say that.
Yeah. But then, like, Mando sees something. He looks at one later in the episode, and it's like a big thing with, like, four legs. So I don't know if those were, like, the same creatures or not, you know? I don't know if there were giant blurgs back there, but I want to know more. I loved it.
It looked like it could have been, like, a hostile, like, looking planet, but it was more like depressed, you know, like you said, like if somebody ran through it and like just everything is just like
it looked,
you know,
like it looked like it used to be like a
sad.
Beautiful and lush Jurassic Park, and then there was a forest fire and all the animals are just like, what do we do now?
Exactly. Like if they're just like, do you think there's food over here?
Yeah,
let's just keep walking.
We're just wandering. Two other things too. Did you notice like the magistrate's guards had blasters that sounded like the sequel era?
Yeah, it was different.
Boom, boom, boom. Not the pew pew. It was like do do, one of those, right? Do do, not pew pew. That's how I differentiate.
I like how they sounded too.
That's what I was doing. I was doing the sound.
Oh no, I you know, sometimes I just think that like you know what I'm thinking. I meant like you know like their mask getup that they're wearing.
Oh. Yes.
Like the way they were talking, they were like, burr, 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 burr. Like that.
That's a good impression. It was, yeah, it was like, it was almost like Death Troopers who could speak English.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. It was pretty cool. I like that too. I'll give you another Dune reference.
I say it time after time. I mean, we're just good at this.
We're just great podcasters. That's all it is. You know, sometimes you just do something, and right from the get-go, you're just perfect at it. That's all this was. Yeah. you can look at episode one and episode today and say, yeah, right, straight from the heart, you know? Hey, first, another Dune reference here. The electro cages they were keeping the prisoners in, very much like something out of Dune called Shiga wire. So Shiga wire is like this, it's almost like fishing line, but if you put it on skin, it just instantly, like, you can like rip right through it like butter. It's just so, Shiga wire is like scary stuff. It's like, so if it like touches you, it just carves off like skin, you know what I mean? On the slightest touches, that it's like infinitesimally sharp. So there are these cages in Dune that are only made of Shiga wire, and you stand in them, and if you move at all, you're just done. You slice and dice. So yeah, that the electric cage totally reminded me of that, because if those guys got tired at all, zap.
I was just gonna say, so when you fall, basically when you fall asleep, you're dead.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, or if you collapse from exhaustion, you're gone. And that's kind of what it reminded me of. Hey, speaking of the spear, let's talk about the spear a little bit. And you know, I loved the ring that the spear made. Like when Mando tapped it, it's like thong. You could tell it was like pure Beskar because of how it sounded. That was super cool. I love that. Did you think the spear looked kind of like a Kenner weapon?
A what?
A Kenner weapon, like a Kenner accessory.
Oh, a Kenner weapon. Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I'm trying to think who had a spear.
I don't know if anyone had a spear. It just kind of, it just looked like it. Like it had like little like rings around the handle and stuff like that. I'm like, dude, that thing looks like a Kenner. Like, I don't know. It just kind of reminded me of that, you know? And I don't hear anyone talking about that.
No, I can see what you're saying, because I mean, it's a very simple design.
Very simple.
You know what I mean? That, like, there's nothing. I mean, the most flashy thing about it is that it's made out of Beskar.
Yeah, exactly. It's just pure. There's no inlay. There's really nothing. You know, it just looks very simple. Like you would like see like a simple Kenner accessory. So I don't know. It was just something that came off the top of my head. One other thing too. So the child's name Grogu. Okay. Before we get into Grogu,
here we go.
Okay, so Bill from Dorklayer had a great theory for it, he threw at us. What if that ball that Grogu likes is a Jedi map reader? Like the, you know? Like,
huh.
And maybe like all along he's wanted to like activate the map reader to, you know, see where his people are or something.
I didn't even think of that. I was just thinking that it was a simple shifter knob.
Bro,
that's it.
It looks it looks a lot like the Jedi map reader. That's
Imagine
all I'm saying.
He just does like his Jedi thing and it just opens up and there's like a map.
Exactly. How crazy
like,
would that
this
be?
This is where Luke Skywalker is.
mm-hmm.
Everybody was looking for him.
Yeah. This is the place this is the place the Jedi used to get great subs.
See, that would be more like our speed. They're like, hey, this place has great ribs. I'm like, let's go.
Yeah. I mean, we used Google Maps. I mean, what do you think Jedi Maps had? I mean, I think it had like great hotels, great food. I think all that stuff was laid out there. If you're going on a Jedi mission, you need to find all the great places, right? You know?
Yeah, well, they gotta eat, and we all know Grogu loves to eat.
All right, let's talk about Grogu, the child, Baby Yoda. His name is Grogu. What do you think of the name?
It grew on me instantly. Number one, I love the fact that Ahsoka could talk to him.
Oh, I love that conversation. They're just like, you know, just like the facial.
Yeah, like he's like... Yeah. You can understand him, you know, like,
cool.
When she's like Grogu and he's like Grogu, but when he says Grogu, Grogu's like, huh?
the noise.
Like it was like, wait a second. Like he knows my name.
The noise is so funny. Like every time he says, gung. It's like one of those.
and the thing is like, we know from seeing the bond that they have.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But now because we can't understand Grogu, but now we can kind of understand him through this episode with Ahsoka, how she was saying like how attached he is, how strong the bond is,
like a father.
Dude, I'm telling you right now, like if I was the Mandalorian, I personally would be like, I'm really sorry, but I can't deliver him. You know, like if he wants to stay with me, I'm not gonna push him to leave.
Well,
you know?
I think that Ahsoka influenced that, because you know we'll see later on that I think the attachment is growing. from Mando for the child. You know, we'll talk about that next episode.
Yeah, it's just one of those things. Because I think, I don't know if we're talking about it on air or off air, but I think maybe Mando is just basically like looking at his life and just being like, if you stay with me, this is the type of life you're going to have.
Yeah.
And I think he's thinking if he delivers him to the Jedi or, you know, for him to be what he was set out to be,
yeah,
he would have a better life than what he would with him. You know what I mean? So
exactly.
I think that's the fight within that's happening here.
So Ahsoka doesn't want to train him. Let's back up. Let's talk everything we know about Grogu. He was raised at the Jedi Temple on Coruscant. We don't know how he got there. Is he the child of Yaddle and Yoda? We don't know. Was he brought there by his people? We don't know. He was taught by many masters. I didn't think that doesn't sound like it was normal, right? And I don't think Ahsoka made it sound like it was normal either. Did you pick up on that?
Well,
younglings don't seem to be taught by many masters, right?
Well, usually they're kind of assigned, like, from the get-go, right? To, like, one.
Well, you get a Padawan when you're older, but I didn't think, like, when you're a youngling. I thought Yoda taught the younglings, mostly.
Well, I wonder if it's one of those things that, like, when we saw Yoda teaching those younglings, was Yoda, like, the history teacher, and then Oberyn's is the math teacher, and, like,
maybe.
I don't know, like...
Or maybe we have a third Yoda, okay? Yodas require like the special attention. He's getting all the special guys. Like Mace, you got him Tuesday. Coyote Monday, you get him Wednesday, right? Like we all gotta train this guy because he's the next Yoda. He's like, you know, there's only five of us in the entire universe, or like maybe it's something like that. You know what I mean? It could be something crazy like that. So after that, he was hidden during the Jedi Purge. Someone took him from the temple. That implies to me that the Grogu doesn't know who took him from the temple, and Ahsoka doesn't recognize who took him from the temple, right? Like, and then things go dark, and his memories are dark, and he doesn't really remember much, and he was lost. What does that mean? I don't know, right? Like, was he drugged? How did he end up where he ended up?
I was going to say, like, after whatever, I mean, he must have had a rough go at it because he ended up being basically a prisoner in a hover crib.
Yes.
So either the Jedi that took him got killed and, like, left him to, like, this drifter, to another drifter that sold him for money.
He eventually ended up in the Empire's, in the Empire's hands. And then was stolen again by a bunch of Nyctos. Remember that? You know, that's where we find him. So, you know, I don't know what's going on there. It's pretty crazy. He's hidden his abilities to survive over the years. It feels like every time he had to hide, like most Jedi during the Purge had to hide their abilities to survive. But it seems like very important that he did, especially, because if anyone noticed that this guy could use the Force, you know, he would be vulnerable. He would be taken, much like the Empire did to him. So here's the question to you, Chris. Does he act more babyish than he is? Is he kind of like Yoda, who acted like a wacko on Dagobah, right? Like just a total nut job? Like, is he kind of putting up the act to kind of, you know, endear himself and make himself look less harmless? Like, maybe... You know, he's 50 years old. We don't know what the species is like. Is he putting on a little bit more of an act?
Well,
because Ahsoka was like,
I was wondering.
Yeah. Let's hear what you have to say.
Well, no, I was wondering, like, at what age does he start to talk?
Right. Maybe. You know,
like, do they start talking when they're 100 or 60?
Are we
going to hear him speak?
Can he talk? Can he talk already? And he's just not doing it because he's scared? Because Ahsoka senses much fear in him? Has he kind of put on the act of being a baby all this time? And maybe he's just very, very tiny at the moment, but he's not necessarily a total baby. Maybe he's like a kid. You know, remember when, like, when Mando was like, you know, he doesn't know what you're saying, and she's like, he understands me. She knows, you know, his true nature more than anything else. I think Ahsoka really kind of like clued into that maybe there's more going on to Grogu than she even told Mando. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. I thought that was very, very interesting. But she senses fear, and she says he's attached to Mando, and because of the fear and because of the attachment, he's vulnerable to his fears and his anger, and she won't train him. Because, of course, you know, good old Anakin. And she just won't bring him down that path, and she says it's better for him to forget his training and let his powers fade. Yeah, so I don't know. I thought that was very, very interesting. Makes sense, right? It makes a lot of sense to think about that from her perspective.
No, it does, and I was just gonna say from her perspective, I could totally understand.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but she does tip her of being like, you know, bring him to this place and see if anybody answers the call.
Yeah, yeah.
So, like, come and train him.
Later on in the episode, yeah, she does, like, kind of have more of a change of heart. You know, go to Tython, place Grogu on the Seeing Stone at the top of the mountain. There, Grogu may choose his path. So, yeah, leave it up to him to see what he wants to do. Maybe a Jedi will feel it, you know, hear his call and find him. So that's really interesting that's what she believes his strategy should be. Yeah, we'll see what happens there. And she walks off. She walks off into the distance, and that was about it for,
you know what,
for her.
What else I thought was really interesting is, like, when he first met Ahsoka, like, those people, quote, yeah, unquote, hire him.
The magistrate, you know, Morgan Elsbeth. Yeah.
Yeah, like, hey, you can have this Beskar spare if you go take care of the Jedi.
Yeah.
And then when he meets up with Ahsoka, like, they have a few exchanges, and I don't think he even tells her until there's like a, it's almost like a, gave him a reason to tell her, like, hey, yeah, they wanted me to kill you.
Yeah.
And then she was like, Oh, okay.
Well, exactly. Exactly.
Let's go take care of this.
A Jedi and a Mandalorian, they'll never see it coming.
They didn't.
Yeah. What a great line, you know? I thought that was really cool. So let's talk a little bit the magistrate. I thought that was a great performance too. By a veteran actor, Diana Lee Inosanto, who was, you know, she was the goddaughter of Bruce Lee and the daughter of an amazing martial arts actor and performer. So, you know, she got the chops, and what a fight that was, huh? Between Ahsoka and her. What a fight.
Yeah. You know, what's crazy is all I kept thinking about was Ahsoka. Like, I felt like that was going to be a quick one.
Yeah.
Like Ahsoka should have had that, but she struggled a little bit, but I think the only reason why there was a struggle is because I was just looking at this lady because I didn't know who she was. Like, just, she's just like a regular lady with a Beskar spear. Like, why don't you just take her out? But I wasn't thinking, like, maybe she was a very skilled fighter.
Oh,
you
yeah.
know, like,
oh,
it's very,
yeah.
it's very, very, very possible. You
oh,
know?
So I got something for you. What do we know about Magistrate Morgan Elsbeth? Her people were massacred, in the Clone Wars. So she became a powerful figure and sold stuff to the Empire and became very powerful. What if she's a Night Sister? What if she's a Night Sister?
Oh.
Oh yeah, yeah. You know, she has, like, you know, head tattoos and stuff. It's what if she's a Night Sister?
Oh, I didn't even think of that.
Yeah,
and just like
dude.
Grew out her hair and like yep. Okay, I was a Night Sister. Let's keep that on the DL.
Yeah,
you know,
man.
And I'm this now.
Yeah, yeah,
oh,
yeah.
So do you think that? All right, if this, let's just say if this is true, right? So do you think her character was not killed? Do you think her character is alive? Do you think Ahsoka killed this lady?
Yeah. You don't really see what happens, do you?
No, there was no confirmed death, you know? I mean, you hear it drop, but you don't see a body.
We don't really hear what happened either. But, did she tell Ahsoka about her master, Grand Admiral Thrawn? What a drop that was, too. Like, oh, yeah. We're,
you guys, I'm telling you,
there's no series, but, you know, there might be live action series. We'll see. But when did it happen, right? Did it happen before The Mandalorian? Or did it happen after? That Rebels epilogue, I don't know. It could have happened anytime.
The thing.
Do I still got it? Did I lose it?
You know, just to be all out of love here, the longer it went on for, you lost me.
Okay. All right. That's fair.
It's the short burst that I'm like, dude, he's getting good.
I'm really not. It's fair though. It's fair. I understand.
No, you know what happened. You know what happened was, like, you know, I was like, Joe, that was like next level.
Yeah.
Your confidence really built up. You had that twinkle in your eye.
I did.
I saw that twinkle in your eye.
Yeah. Yeah. The twinkle
shouldn't have been there. Like,
yeah.
So. I would like to think that Ahsoka just offed this lady. You know what I mean? Because there's no reason to keep her alive. She seemed like a terrible person, and she was like basically enslaving these people. Mm-hmm. So she had to go.
She got to go. So she already murdered like 50 people in this episode. Why not murder one more? Right.
Well, this is true.
Yeah.
I mean, what's the matter at this point?
Yeah. Ahsoka's a dirty murderer. That's all it is. She is. She's a bloody, bloody murderer. That's who Ahsoka is now. That's fine.
Yeah, you know, because all I kept thinking about too is like, okay, this is great. We're seeing Ahsoka. Oh man, this is amazing. Oh, she looks so great. Mm-hmm. And then I kept thinking, why is she there? Like, what's her mission?
She's getting information for Grant. She's getting information to find Thrawn. I understand. Cool. Yeah,
like throughout like the episode, like as mm-hmm. it's beginning, as it's going on, I'm like, okay, so like, why is she here? You know, like, and then it's just like right when she was like, I didn't know who she was looking for. I really wasn't expecting her to say like Thrawn, and then all I kept thinking about was like, okay, so they must have got a lead that I don't know. Maybe word's getting around that Thrawn's popping up.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? Like Thrawn's back, so that means Ezra's back.
Well, she went to she. Where is your master? Like, who calls Grand Admiral Thrawn their master? Like, he was a military dude. Like, what is going on with that? That's a very interesting relationship. So what is Grand Admiral Thrawn up to? And I'm telling you guys, I'm sorry. This whole episode takes place before the Rebels epilogue. I don't care what you say. Think about it. If this took place after the Rebels epilogue, then she'd be with Sabine Wren. You know, it would be stupid. It would be stupid to not have Sabine Wren if she went and picked up Sabine Wren to find Thrawn. I think she got the info and then went back to Sabine being like, I know where she is. Let's go. Right? Doesn't that make sense?
Yeah, because, well, the thing too is I don't think they make it clear on time frames during that, because it's like you see like Hera and her son, and you know that she helped on the Death Star too.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? So you know that she was around during Return of the Jedi. But then when they cut to like Ahsoka and Sabine being like, hey, let's go find Ezra, and you know what I mean, I don't like the way that they're showing it. You know, your mind wants you to think like, oh, this is like boom, boom,
yeah,
boom,
boom,
like
boom,
this,
boom.
It must be this time frame.
Yeah.
But like, you actually don't know because it's vague.
It is vague. So, I mean, I just think that you can't be like, oh, well, maybe Sabine was just not with Ahsoka right now. That doesn't make any sense. That would be a ridiculous way to kind of retcon that. Because if Sabine picks up Ahsoka, if Ahsoka picks up Sabine, and the next time you see Ahsoka, she's not with Sabine, then the continuity is lost. You know, if that's supposed to be happen like that. But if Ahsoka's alone and then goes picks up Sabine, it makes sense logically. You know, this isn't like some weird Rubik's Cube. You know, this is just storytelling. It's just storytelling. It just makes sense. You know,
it could be that they found them. Maybe Sabine is with Ezra. And Ahsoka's like, no, I need to go hunt down Thrawn.
Yeah, that would be weird, though, right? Because the last time you saw them, they were together. So now you'd be asking, well, why aren't they together now? You know? And that story isn't really there yet. So you're going to have to really sell me if this all happened. And Filoni kind of was very coy about it. He didn't say, yeah, it happened afterwards. He was like, you know,
Star Wars is never very linear.
So,
well, they're playing it really smart, obviously, because really think about it. They're just planting eggs everywhere, dude. They're planting seeds, I mean, planting eggs. Jesus, my head's on eggs still. But they're planting seeds everywhere because what they're doing is, like, Ahsoka could have her own TV show.
Big time.
Boba Fett could have his own TV show.
I think it's all happening, kid. It's all happening. Yeah,
I think that's what they're doing because I would... They could grill me so much for, like, okay, so when did this happen? I'd be like, I'm not. Next question.
We're talking the Star Wars connected TV universe. That's what we're talking.
Yeah, because, you know? I mean, if they're going to go in that direction, they already knocked it way out of the park.
Hey,
we're talking Grand Salami.
We're talking Favreau started the MCU, and now he's starting the Star Wars TVU. That's what's happening. All interconnected series. Yeah.
It's genius at its best level because they're all beloved characters and everybody would want to see more. And everything is so like what is Ahsoka's agenda? What's Boba's agenda? I can keep going with characters here. You know what I mean? Like,
mm-hmm.
we could get like 4 TV shows out of The Mandalorian.
I feel like we're getting 4 TV shows out of this episode.
it's true.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely, definitely.
And we're over here planting our, we're over here laying our own eggs.
We're planting our own eggs. That was a big wandoozle of a show right there. We talked a lot about a lot of things right there. We did. Chris, did you see the convor at the beginning of the episode? You know, that little owl that's supposed to represent the sister?
Yeah, I already trained myself when I'm watching something.
Yeah.
Just look in the background.
You look in the corners.
There's always like little, little Easter eggs everywhere.
Yeah, look in the corners. For sure. For sure.
Yeah.
That's Star Wars right there.
There's an owl. There's a loth cat.
Yeah. Like, oh, you saw the loth cat as well. I did see the loth cat. That was very cool.
Yeah.
Hey, yeah. You called it, kid. You called it. Beskar can repel lightsabers. Who knew? Who knew?
You know what's really weird, Joe? And, you know, so I said something that turned out to be right in this episode, and you said something. You predicted something that ended up totally happening.
Like what?
In the next episode.
Oh, in the next one. Yeah, I don't know what you're talking about, but I can't wait to get to it.
You guys are just gonna have to tune in to the next episode.
I guess so. Find out on the next episode. Yeah. Some final thoughts here. This episode definitely had like a very Kurosawa feel to it. I love the Japanese inspired like fortress town. It also felt like the Clone Wars in the best possible way, and that's very much due to Dave Filoni directing. Just the actual way the story was set up with, you know, some interlaced themes and plot lines all coming together. You know, very, very Star Wars, very, very Clone Wars. The rotoscoping effect on Ahsoka's lightsaber looked so choice. It looked so good. I loved everything they did with that. That duel. Oh my god, the duel between Ahsoka and the Magistrate. Very Kill Bill to me. Very Kill Bill.
Oh yeah.
And I was wondering when they were setting
I
up.
Can see that.
I was wondering if you guys said we were gonna get another Obi-Wan and Darth Maul. You know, like one swipe kill. I was like, oh, that'd be so cool. But also, I want a little more. You know what I mean? Mm. Yeah. But that's a wrap, guys. We'll see you next time. You know where to find us. And until then, you know, Star Wars. I'm afraid the party's canceled. The summits never showed. On the wall was penciled. I was full of bloody notes. Force getting ready. Man, we get too much. On the wall was suffer. The Wookiee's wicked clutch.